Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to the tutorial session. As you know, tutorials means that rather than doing a lecture and so on, we try to solve some problems together. Being online together means you are just there. It is a one-way affair. But generally, if we are in the classroom, then tutorials are in a much better atmosphere where we interact with each other, and then you can have questions and so on. So let us start. We initially have some multiple choice questions, then we will move on to the other types. So there are of course a few selected ones. There could be many others in the course. Let's start with the first one. In tempered alloy steels, cleavage usually initiates at what? Grain boundary carbides, GBC, spherical carbides, SC, inclusions, I, spherical carbides or inclusions. So if you remember your mechanisms chapter 5, then for tempered alloy steels, which means that these are alloy steels which have gone through the tempering heat treatment. So at spherical carbides and at inclusions, their cleavage usually initiates. Number two, yield strength is the same as the ultimate strength in the case of dash material. Elastic, perfectly plastic, linear strain hardening, non-linear strain hardening, linear elastic. So this would, recall your understanding of that small portion of a lecture where I covered these different types of material models. Linear elastic means there is only elastic behavior. There is no plastic. So in that case, there is no ultimate strength there, right? Linear strain hardening means that from yield strength until ultimate strength, there is a straight line equation, right? This is yield point, that is ultimate point. They are very different. They are not the same. Non-linear strain hardening means from yield point to ultimate, there is a curve as in a real material. But again, the yield point and the ultimate point are two different. Elastic perfectly plastic, if you remember, elastic perfectly plastic, there is a straight line in the elastic region and there is a horizontal straight line in the plastic region. So the yield point or the ultimate point are the same. That is the maximum or the starting of the yielding region, right? So this is the answer. Elastic perfectly plastic, then yield strength and ultimate strength would be the same because it will be behaving as a plastic material, but the strength will not go above yield point. Number three, Wells proposed approximate analysis that related CTOD to K1 for dash yielding. So Wells theory, crack tip opening displacement, mode 1 stress intensity, relationship between them. For what? For what yielding? A small scale, medium scale, larger scale, zero. At the tip of the crack tip, there is some yielding, right? So if you go back to the Wells theory, it was for small scale yielding. For medium scale and larger scale, they are too big. There is too much of plastic work and the basic theories cannot do anything. And zero yielding means it is perfectly brittle. So Wells theory is not required, right? So it was required for a small scale yielding. Next one, based on Irwin's theory, CTOD can be estimated by solving for dash at the actual crack tip. Displacement, stress, strain, any of these. Of course, they could solve for a stress, they could solve for a strain, but if you remember, they were solving for displacement. They were solving for what is the size of the plastic zone at the crack tip. So they were solving for displacement at the crack tip. Next one, condition to be met for this equation to be true. Here, sorry for my typing. This is K1 square. This is sigma ys yield strength. So CTOD is equal to K1 squared upon yield strength into E. This is the equation. You know, you have used it in quizzes also and so on. So what is the condition? There should be a through crack. There should be an infinite plate. the remote stress should be much smaller than yield strength. So all three, all of these three have to be true for this to be met. There is an infinite plate with a through crack, and the remote stress is much smaller than the yield length of the material. Okay. Let us now see a few of the true-false questions. Plastic deformation can be described as time-independent, non-linear material behavior. Right. So yes, this is a correct definition of plastic behavior. Of course, is for non-linear. Right. Generally, plastic deformation cannot be linear, and it is time-independent. Whether it happens now or later on, it depends on the load. If the load is much more than the yield strength, you are in the plastic region and so on. So this is true. Number two, high toughness in metals is not desirable to designers and fabricators because K1C measurement of high toughness material is difficult. So now you see, the main sentence is there. K1C measurement of high toughness materials is difficult, yes. This is true, but high toughness is not desirable by designers. Absolutely untrue. Excuse me. Right. Whenever designers and fabricators are there who need metals, they would want it to have as much higher toughness as possible, because that is what we need for design and manufacturing. Right. This is the other side of it, that you see, if it is a high toughness material, it's K1C measurement will be very difficult. So false. Next one, bimodal particle distributions, intermetallics, second phase precipitates, can lead to shear fracture surfaces. Right. So if you see, when we were discussing bimodal, trimodal distributions of particles, and you go back to that part of the lecture notes or the video lectures and so on, then this is true. In ferritic steels, remember, right, a type of stainless steels and so on, fracture mechanism changes from microvoid coalescence to cleavage as the temperature increases. As the temperature increases, microvoid coalescence is ductile, cleavage is brittle. So they are saying that with increase of temperature, the material is becoming from ductile to brittle. It is the opposite. As temperature increases, more and more ductility is there, right? So this is false. This is opposite to what happens. Intergranular fracture is very common in metals. If you remember, in the chapter when we are discussing it, we initially talk of ductile fracture, then we talk of cleavage fracture, the transgranular, and only in the end we do intergranular fracture. So the most common ones are general ductile fractures and cleavage fractures. Intergranular is not common, right? Intergranular is not common. So of course, it is not true. So that was sort of part A and part B of question one. I'm just giving them some numbers. Now let us go to another question. This is a full long question. Catastrophic fracture occurred in a thick steel plate during proof testing at an applied stress of 700 megapascals. The initiating defect was an embedded sharp penny shaped flaw with a radius of 2.5 centimeter. It is desired to find out the fracture toughness of this steel by determining the plane strain fracture toughness from a standard test using a sheet of nominally similar steel 7.5 millimeter thick. Yield strength of the steel is 1100 megapascal. Any comments? So now, all through the tutorial session, that generally in any course when I'm doing the tutorials, the questions I select could be some important good questions from the lectures which I'm trying to repeat, or they could be questions from your quizzes and midterms and so on, or some other places. But they are good questions which if you really understand, then your understanding of the course increases, and your ability to solve problems also increases. So now you decide that out of the quizzes or midterms and so on that you have been doing, which ones are these or are they from some other source? So once again, right, it is a penny-shaped crack, so circular crack, and the radius is given, the other things are given. If you have done it earlier, good. Otherwise, you can pause my lecture here and try to do it yourself, as I always ask you. Or if you just want to directly listen to the solution, then you can go to the next slide. Otherwise, always that if it is, you're taking this tutorial as a practice for you, then start solving it, even though you have solved it earlier also. And once you have solved it, then you come back and look at the solution. And for solving means read it again carefully, take down the knowns and the unknowns, and then start solving, right? Okay. So applied stress is this, radius of the penny shaped flaw is this, okay, thickness of the plate from which you will cut the specimen is this, yield strength of the steel is this, right? So I have written now that sigma is 700 megapascal, A is 2.5 centimeter, right? It is the radius, that is also A. Heat thickness is this, K1C is unknown. And this I forgot, that sigma ys is 1100. Now assume y is equal to 1, right? Because in any fracture mechanics problem, you will have the need of y. So assume y is equal to 1, write it carefully. And then you have the standard equation, K1 is equal to y sigma root pi A. Y sigma root pi A. Now, initially, you may have thought that you write, assume y is equal to 1 and this is right. No, I deliberately put it there. But if you were in the class, you would say, no, doctor, what are you doing? It is given that it is a sharp penny shaped crack. So in the case of a sharp penny shaped crack, we will take y is equal to 2 upon pi. We will take y is equal to 2 upon pi. We do not need to assume it to be 1. Right? It is a penny shaped crack. And then in the equation for a penny shaped crack, right, we want to do this. So, right, so it is 2 upon pi. So now it is there. So just if this is the K equation, and then if it fails under the test, then this will become K1C. So 2 upon pi sigma is 700 megapascal, right? Applied stress, and this A is 2.5 centimeter, so 0.025. Remember, we want everything to be in metric units and so on. So this comes out to be 124.9 megapascal root meter. A very simple problem. A very simple problem. But what was the small catch? Let us go. If this is assumed to be a valid plane strain fracture toughness value, then the minimum specimen thickness is this. Remember, B is the minimum thickness, 2.5 K1C upon sigma ys whole square. We found K1C to be 124.9, sigma ys was given to be 1100 megapascal. So the thickness comes out to be 32.2 millimeter. The thickness comes out to be 32.2 millimeter. But the material that was available had 7.5 millimeter thickness only. 7.5 millimeter thickness only. So if this is the sheet material from where you will cut the specimen, then this thickness will not be enough. So the value of the K1C that we have found out is not valid, right? So hence the thickness of the steel in the stock is insufficient. One would order the next standard plate thickness greater than 32.2, maybe 35 millimeter, right? So this is your comment, that we found out the K1C, but this K1C is not valid because the thickness of the actual plate from which we cut it is much lower than the thickness we would require for a valid plane strain test. Therefore, we would ask the supplier to give a higher thickness sheet and then we will cut the material from there.